Hi everyone, this is Mike Naraki, director of The Pirates Who Don't Do Anything.
And Phil Vischer, writer of the same.
And Paula Marcus, I produced it.
And this is the commentary.
Of the movie.
Under glorious music.
That you're hopefully watching.
This is the Big Idea logo. Right here. We're going to, remember, we had some ideas to actually combine the Big Idea logo and the Universal logo.
Yeah.
Including Bob spinning around as a big red tomato.
Yeah, but it didn't happen.
Might do it one of these
didn't
days.
Didn't happen because of lawyers. I'm almost
It was
positive.
Storyboarded.
Yeah, you can storyboard anything.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean they'll let you make it.
Right, never got done.
Okay, so this movie started. We made Jonah. Do you remember Jonah, Mike?
I do.
Okay, that's
yeah.
good. That was back, came out in 2002, and near the end of producing Jonah, I had written another film called The Bob and Larry Movie, which was really kind of complicated and elaborate because it had humans in it, and we realized near the end of Jonah that we couldn't pull it off, that it was too complex and too expensive, and we needed to do something else.
Well, can I stop for a minute and just point out that claw simulation on those flags?
That was awesome.
Isn't that nice?
We'll talk about it when we see it again.
And just the smoke. Look at that smoke. Isn't that nice smoke?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, we really love these three characters, Pirates Who Don't Do Anything, and Jonah. We thought, well, what if we gave them their own piratey adventure? And this was near the end of 2002.
You want to talk about Mauritania?
Mauritania!
Because Monteria.
I want to say that no vegetables were hurt in this movie except in the storyboards for this sequence where the storyboard artist Tim Hodge cut a couple of them with their swords.
Tim did a little fun slicing and dicing in story rules.
It was a little vibe.
Ouch.
We're all aghast.
Are those going to be a DVD bonus feature?
I don't know. I don't know if we want to let those out.
I think we destroyed them.
Okay.
But this whole, the whole world that this was set up in is this, you know, fictitious Caribbean where Robert's hideout ends up being Barbados. And
right,
so they're kind of off. So you can sort of imagine them on a ship outside the north of the coast of South America. It started off as Phil initially named it Mauritania. Yeah, not realizing that's actually the name of a country in Africa.
Right, and boy were they mad. So we had to change it.
Yeah, we got a globe out, showed Phil, and then
I didn't believe him at first, of course.
Yeah, they all wanted to go on a location hunt to look for this
location.
Yeah, wanted
to go to Barbados and check it out.
There it is.
But we couldn't afford it.
But instead, Monteria is actually, so this fictitious kingdom of Monteria is actually the name of a city. It's a small city, maybe more of a town, in northern Colombia, close to the ocean, not right on the ocean, but right on the ocean. Yes.
Really?
Monteria. It means, I guess, land of mountains or something like that.
Oh, well, here we are in the land of mountains. Look at them all.
So the king's kingdom is actually, you know, South America, actually.
Wow.
So, yes.
I did not know that.
Yep, and Robert occupies Barbados, and I'd love to, you know, after the whole film is over, you know, it'd be a fun place to go visit these fictitious places.
Let's go now.
So, what is that? Is that Eloise?
It looks like it's an Eloise.
She's green.
There we go. Oh, check out that window right there. See that window?
Yeah.
That's the first double-hung window on a 17th-century pirate ship.
Right, and when we were doing this, awesome. We had problems whether the window was opened or closed and which way it swung and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, because you figure, you know, in a pirate ship in that era, if it did open, it'd probably just sort of swing out on a hinge on top or something. But you just, you know, it didn't look very good. So we decided to go with the pillar double-hung.
And there's Eloise.
There's
Remember
Eloise.
We did that little test with her bangs?
Oh, yeah, Eloise Bangs. Yeah, originally, the way that she was designed initially was actually looked more or less like this, but when we got her into 3D and we modeled her and then started to put her through the paces of animation, she looked like a little Frankenstein.
She had a lot of forehead.
Yeah, a lot of forehead.
So then we gave her some bangs. And
like
she
a little
cute.
A curtain of bangs.
A little curtain of bangs, and she looked cute, but then we got a lot of feedback about, you know, people weren't liking her
Not
bangs
into
as much as
the
her
bangs.
Original
I liked the
design.
Bangs. It made her look younger,
I thought.
Yeah,
it wasn't
cute.
A bad look.
I didn't like them.
I liked them.
But then what we did was we had to go back and reshape her head. Actually take down her forehead and take away
her
bangs.
I had to do that with two of my kids. They're okay now.
Yeah.
Okay.
But she looks cute after all.
Yeah. So who did the voice?
Well, her name is Laura Giroux. And it was fantastic. Actually, it's a fun story about how we came about her voice. Initially, she was, you know, the whole royal family was conceived as British. So the king and Robert, Eloise and Alexander, you know, I was thinking they'd all have, you know, British accents of some sort of another, which Robert and the king do. But when we started to get in audition tapes from our casting agent, Sue Blue, out, isn't that a great name? Out
in Sue Blue
from LA.
From LA. Got a lot of great voices, but a lot of them sounded like, you know, older, you know, actresses trying to sound younger. Some of them with really great British accents, but one of them stood out to me, but it was the accent wasn't that great, but the voice was fantastic. It just right in the age range and right in the feeling that I was looking for. And so we ended up changing around a little bit. So we decided, okay, let's use this actress, and you know, not have the prince and princess with British accents.
Right.
So
it worked
pretty well.
And I like music.
And that's her actual voice. That's what she sounds like. Yeah, she's just natural.
Yeah, wow. She's natural.
But she's not a child. No minors.
How do you like those placemats?
Those are cool. Did Chuck paint those?
Oh, remember Somewhere in the Present?
Rob and Tom and Chuck.
Somewhere in the Present was
changed.
Originally Somewhere Last Week. That's what it says in the script, if you go in the script. Somehow that did not survive to see the screen.
Right? There was some confusion about time travel, and people didn't get it.
Because there's one less step that you have to go through. When you say Somewhere Last Week, you kind of have to do the math and say, okay, last week is kind of the present, you know, and it's up for very, very, very short amount of time. So when you actually say present, then it's very clear that, you know,
we're back in the
present. So the
question is, do you consider last week history or current events?
Or is it a
gift? Depends on how busy of a week it was.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah.
All right.
Oh, and it was Ellen. The Ellen character was really fun. Carrie, the actress that did this, did such a great job with the Ellen.
They're trying to conceive of a girlfriend for Mr. Longtooth.
Yeah,
it's kind of a challenge.
I think they're the perfect match.
The theater set was our biggest set, actually. We had to do it in three pieces to get all those people in.
Because it wouldn't fit in the computer.
They wouldn't all fit in the computer. Yeah, it is. It's so funny because we go into these massive, you know, beautiful sea panoramas. But this set is actually the biggest set in the whole film, just because of the amount of characters, the amount of props, and, you know, so everything had to be rendered in layers and lighted in layers.
Yeah, and how'd you fill it full of people?
Well, there are a lot of the Veggie Tales people that you've seen before, and most of them are sitting there twice, if you look really carefully.
And are there any hidden ETs or Wookiees?
Maybe.
Originally, Junior Asparagus was sitting right there in that row in front of the girls, but he was just too obvious as being a main character.
Expect him to burst into song.
Right. So instead, we put a little P in there with a hat.
But we did a whole seating chart with all of the Veggie characters.
So they had assigned seats.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they had assigned seats.
And they weren't allowed to change.
It's like throwing a wedding.
They had to find their seats every day.
That's right.
Oh, and remember the humongous ketchup and all of the big props.
We had some scaling issues in this because we actually did a lot of pre-vis work with wireframe models before we even started storyboarding, and we can talk about more of that later. But we actually had. Sir Frederick, who is the main character on the pirate ship at this point, he was kind of misscaled when we did that pre-vis work, and so it threw off the scale for the whole theater. And so
he'd been eating too much the crab table?
Yeah. Well, his real model was bigger than the fake model that we were using.
And so
So when we actually put Sir Frederick on the pirate ship, he was way too big. So then we had to scale the pirate ship along with the rest of the restaurant up, and then it got way too big for the rest of the characters. So it was a little bit of a...
How did you survive it?
We had a lot of tweaking to do afterwards.
I bet.
A lot of tweaking.
And you think it's okay that George has kids? Because some people, you know, say, well, Pa Grape doesn't have for his kids. We've gave him other kids in another show. I think people can suspend their disbelief about...
He's an actor. He doesn't even have the same name as he has normally.
Yeah, that's what I was hoping.
That's right.
Some people
Harrison Ford has had a number of different kids in his films.
And in his real life. I'm pretty sure. But
hey, my little girl... is
where?
Next to George there.
Playing
my daughter in real life, Allie.
Yeah.
Allie does the voice of Lucy. Right here
she
comes.
There she is with
Oh,
hey.
Like father, like daughter.
Yeah,
that was brilliant. Oh, look how sad he is.
Oh, this is very sad.
Have we ever made Pa that sad in a film before?
I don't think so.
Well, notice that he's wearing glasses through this entire movie.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, why is he wearing glasses?
To give him more emotion.
To give him more emotion. George is technically the hero of this whole movie. It's, you know, it's a story about the pirates who don't do anything. But George is the one we track the most emotionally through the whole film. And so, you know, it was some of the early feedback we got, you know, from Universal to, you know, want to, you know, make sure we could get as much emotion out of George as possible. And at first they wanted us to give him eyes.
Yeah.
That was...
That suggestion was not well received.
We were kind of nervous about that. We actually drew a couple of illustrations with him with eyes and we all screamed.
And ran out of the room.
But the glasses and the eyebrows show so much emotion.
Yeah, and I'm actually really glad we did it. I really like his character, his pirate character with the glasses and the eyebrows.
But if you go back to all the old stuff with him as a pirate, he's never had glasses when he was wearing his pirate hat.
Right, exactly. Yeah, he frequently wears glasses, never with his pirate hat, but I do like him in his pirate hat look.
Yeah, but he wasn't the lead before.
Yeah. Yes. Now, this character and the role he plays is a not very heavily veiled reference to one of my favorite movies of all time, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, by the Coen brothers, which also use a sort of a semi-mythical character to set up, to foreshadow the adventure that's about to happen.
Like the Odyssey, I guess is what it would be, right?
Yes. Yes.
He's a Dapper Dan man.
Although I've wondered why, you know, who was running the lights in the theater and why the lights all changed. When
Andy was running the lights.
Yeah,
oh, Andy.
Andy's up there. He's Q3.
Q, mysterious visitor in the theater.
Here's an interesting piece of trivia. Initially, Bob the Tomato, because of his lack of appearance elsewhere in the film, we were going to have him come in here. He was going to be from the nursing home, saying that the bus is about ready to leave.
Yeah. And what happened to that?
It just took too much time.
Yeah. And we found another place for Bob. You'll have to keep watching the movie.
Yeah.
Oh,
Bob
I will.
Later. Yeah.
I can't wait.
Yeah. So I liked his little hat, though. He had like on a little trucker hat. He looked cute in it. So.
Okay, but we learned a lot about pacing, didn't we?
We did.
Gotta keep the movie going.
Gotta keep it going. We actually had a whole scene that we cut out.
It was the best scene in the whole movie.
I think it will have it on the DVD. It actually is. It makes history as the first ever completely animated and rendered and lighted, cut scene from VeggieTales. So,
and you get to watch it.
And it's a bonus track now, so it's very nice.
Somewhere,
but it really—I mean—it's a nice little scene and informs George's character very nicely. But it just, you know,
the movie got a little too long.
We wanted to get him into the past a little quicker.
Yeah, the first reel was just a little too slow.
A little slow, yeah.
But now look at it—it's crispy.
Well, this is another thing we cut a little short here. Is the this audition scene was originally about 30 seconds longer. We took it down.
Right. Sometimes less is more.
And sometimes more is more.
Avast, you scurvy dogs! You came from the sea, and to the sea you shall return! And
Pa really enjoyed this part.
Did he?
Yeah, he always wanted to do this. Be a pirate, be a hero. He'd learned the lines years ago. He's known all the lines for the whole show. Mr. Lund was a little more hesitant about the role.
Now remember, he's Sedgwick now.
But I mean, Lund was playing the role.
Right.
You know, but he was, you know, he doesn't like the physical exertion thing so much.
Bit of an extensive use of matte painting throughout this whole film. Like everything you're seeing, the ceiling plates and the background plates are all painted, all those clouds in the background. And we look up and see the lights. See those lights right there?
Yeah.
Those are background paintings.
Really?
Right. Chuck Bomer, our production designer, did an amazing job. I mean, his fingerprint is on every frame of this film.
Yeah. And
literally.
Andrew Woodhouse was Chuck's
sidekick
and getting so much done. Just paint, you know, things that didn't quite look good enough in 3D with you know, just the way they turned out with final lighting and modeling. They went in and did a ton of painting fixes and touch-ups just to get everything to integrate in perfectly with each other.
So how about this alley?
Yeah, you know, this was actually inspired by a Nashville alley. So
really?
Joe Spatterford, our one of our production artists, who actually lives in Nashville, went out with his camera and took a couple of alley snapshots. And
was he in any danger?
In Nashville, I don't think so.
No, yeah, being assaulted by a country music artist. They can get testy when they're out of work.
I'm glad we cut out the laugh at the end of that line. It was a good thing.
Actually, and that's interesting because Joe Spatterford, who actually did the alleyway design, was the voice of Jacob Lewis.
Right.
So he did the little laugh that got cut.
That's right.
That's Joe's garbage truck.
Joe's garbage truck. Yeah,
one of the nicest garbage trucks ever to show up in a CGI film.
Right, and it's too bad we don't see it more. Yeah,
have to bring it back.
Do you think we could make a collectible toy based on the garbage truck? Do you think it had enough appearance to warrant that?
But we should do one on the Help Seeker.
Oh, the Help Seeker. That's a Paul Conrad design. Paul, over at Pixar now. Shout out to Paul.
Hi,
how's it going, Paul?
Hi, Paul.
I like the fisheye thing.
Yeah,
that's cool. And Paw's the pirate hat has a new logo.
Yes, that is the dinner theater logo, the Pieces of Eight. If you'll notice, Ron Eddy, who did the design for that very cleverly, it's a P. So you can see the letter P on there and the fork and the knife underneath.
Yeah.
But George, it's sort of worn off a little bit, so it kind of vaguely resembles a pirate in Skull and Crossbones.
Yeah.
Cleverly.
Without being scary.
Without being scary.
We don't want to scare the kids.
No.
No, but this is where the fun starts.
Oh, hey, you know, I want to talk a little bit about sort of the visual language for the film that we used. It's kind of interesting. We just saw where the camera pulled back before the boat dropped.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, yeah. Took a seminar a few years ago from Bruce Block. Remember Bruce Block?
Yeah,
Bruce Block. He came in and gave us a seminar and talked about visual language.
He's a legend.
He's a legend. And what we did in the film was we assigned kind of their emotional state to how we filmed them. And, you know, with the use of deep space, limited space, and flat space, that is to say, you know, really, you know, if they're kind of standing in front of just in front of a wall, that's called flat space.
And, right.
You know, you can see clear vanishing points. That's a deep space.
Right. And then Star Wars was all in deep space.
Yes.
Right.
Deep space. That's right.
Yeah.
See, and so we're saying kind of their laziness and their not doing anythingness to flat space.
Yeah.
And whenever they actually go into adventure, you know, we shoot them in deep space.
Now, this was the scene that really started the whole film, because I was trying
look
to think.
Look at the water.
Look at the water.
Beautiful.
Doesn't it look lovely. Wet?
Yes, our effects people
water.
Up at Starz Animation did an amazing job bringing the water into the computer. It's all real.
To the computer. Didn't short anything.
But the whole story pursuit kind of started out with, okay, what if these three pirates got dropped into a real pirate adventure, which then led to literally dropping them into, you know, the 17th century in a rowboat, which then led to, okay, well, what would happen next? And how did they get there? What happened before? Which so the whole film was built out from this scene right here.
And that particular shot of them dropping in, you know, when we...
Oh, I love when Sedgwick hits his head.
Look at that. That was inspired. We took the cinematography as inspiration, the Balrog shot, as Gandalf is fighting the Balrog.
In Lord of the Rings.
At the beginning of number two, Lord of the Rings, as they're falling from the sky.
That was a little violent, though. This is less violent.
It was much less violent than fighting a Balrog.
More age appropriate.
A lot less violent than fighting a Balrog.
This wasn't in the script.
Lord
this was all ad-libbed. Talking literally, Phil.
Yeah. Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't.
It worked.
The pirate ships, how many different unique ships were actually built?
Oh, man. I'd say six.
Really?
Six or seven boats. Michael
Holy
Spooner,
cow.
An amazing artist. Michael worked with us in Jonah as well and was at Big Idea for a number of years, and he worked with us on a freelance basis for this film. Did a lot of the ship design and just did an amazing job on them. But the Steadfast, that's the name of this the princess's ship right here. The Stub, which is the name of Robert's ship, are the two biggest sort of detailed out ships. We also have the King's ship. And then One-Eyed Louie's ship, and we have the rowboat,
and were they
we have the pirate yacht.
Completely unique, or did they have lots of interchangeable parts?
Well, the Stub and One-Eyed Louie's ship are actually the same ship. Okay. They're just colored differently, and they've got different props attached.
And the sails and masts were all sort of interchangeable, like you had one of these and two of these.
But, you know, the Steadfast is definitely the most complex ship, and it actually has, you know, it comes in different sets. This is the onboard set. So if you were to pull out, if you were to actually physically take the camera and pull it out from this set, there wouldn't be a boat beneath it. And so we actually did a wide view of model of the ship as well. And, you know, unlike Jonah, which is where we built one ship and detailed it infinitely, so you'd be able to shoot it as close as you want to or as far away. We just found that to be a really cumbersome. Yes, very cumbersome. Yes. So this way, what we did was we just built what we needed to for the cameras that we needed. So it was much more lightweight, and we would just substitute in different ships.
So would you say we've learned a lot?
We've learned our lesson.
We've done things in the past.
That's right. Yeah, when we could go in on Jonah's ship and open a barrel and find 80 fish in it, fully modeled, in a barrel that we would never had to open really on camera. You know, we figured we needed to do something different the next time around.
One of the goals in a CGI film is to try to put the budget on the screen.
That's right.
As much as possible.
I wouldn't let you put all those fish in the barrel.
Right. No.
We got much more money on the screen in this film than we did in Jonah. And I think that's why it looks so pretty.
So pretty. Are you ready for adventure? I thought this interaction was fun where they each kind of have to powwow on each end and
we had one of the shots in there initially. We were going to do the typical huddle shot, you know, where you got we do it for a little bit here, but we lock the camera down. Initially, we were going to shoot it as sort of a slowly rotating huddle, and it made me nauseous
after
a while. I started talking, like, I don't feel so good.
We have those storyboards,
lock it down
too.
And cut away.
You decided that was bad for a movie to make people physically nauseous?
Yeah, well, you know, got to pick your points in a film. Sometimes it's good.
Sometimes
in the roller
coaster
scene.
How do you start this thing?
I love the wood on the ship and the detailing on the edges and how it's worn off.
Well, Chuck Vollmer, the art director on the film, is actually a woodworker in his own right, so he just loves wood, and so it was very important to him to get the wood exactly right. And you can really tell. I mean, it's just those little touches, like how the wood is worn on the edges and you know, just
looks,
the grain.
It's like Snow White.
It does. It has a very cell, you know, classic, you know, almost Disney feel to it.
Yep.
You know, Pinocchio, we used Pinocchio as visual reference for the wood.
No, Snow White.
Snow White. Yeah, that too. and it's, you know, and the other thing, just the stylization, we didn't want to go photorealistic with anything, so everything has a really nice stylized feel to it, including
sure does.
The water.
Oh, look.
Here we are, back at Robert.
Cloth simulations.
This
was an added scene. This wasn't in the original script, but we felt like we had gone away from the bad guy for too long, so we needed to come back and make sure that he was still all right.
And that the audience
remembered
he existed.
There's the bad guy. As I was writing, I'd completely forgotten about him. Like, what?
Bad guy. Oh, yeah.
I'm just having fun with my pirates. How many does, like, the Robert, his beard wiggles? You know, his beard. And look, and his scarf little things wiggle there.
Oh, yeah. There's a nice little secondary animation.
Lots of that stuff.
IK stuff.
You know, that's not cheap either.
No, it's not. And look at Willery's little, what do you call those little, is it Dickie? What do you call those?
That's not what we call it, Mike.
I don't know what the scarves are called,
it's like an ascot.
That's right.
Something like that. But look at
I'm thinking of a doily. That's what
I'm
thinking
of.
Well, it looks a little, the texture is amazing.
That's
the texture is so beautiful on all the clothing and everything.
Something to say about the layout of these whip cracks. Here's another thing where scaling was a major issue. When they built the ship, you know, was built separately from these rocks. And the rocks were built to a scale that were just like Mount Everest scale. so what ended up happening to get to get them, you know, to the right size on the ship they were just like little bitty tips of icebergs sticking up out of the water, but they had completely lost all their sharpness, you know, just like, you know, if you went in on the head of a pin with an electron microscope, it would look flat. That's what happened with these.
Wow.
And so,
have you done that?
Yeah, I have. Yeah, on a head of a pin of a needle,
yeah.
Head of a pin.
In
but anyways,
school?
So we had to, once we got all that in the layout, we had to go back and rescale everything kind of the same scale.
Every shot had to be redone with the rocks.
Yeah.
We had to go through and
a nightmare.
Yeah, we had Whipcrack Island rock placement.
Yeah, yeah. So the rock placement in itself, you know, turned into a big deal, but it turned out looking great. So it became a real, you know, item of art direction as to exactly where to put those rocks.
Wow.
So, and the other thing too is just getting this look right here in this mist to kind of pick out the ship. Is there a ship? Is it a rock?
Right.
What is it?
So how many days do you think were spent placing rocks?
Oh,
in this scene.
2 weeks.
2 weeks around.
Two weeks of rock placement.
Yeah.
Holy cow.
Yeah.
Man, that's why I got out of the movie business. That's crazy. I'll write them, but don't make me place the rocks.
Yeah, but
that looks so nice, doesn't it?
What was that? Cannonball?
Yeah, it's a cannonball. There we go.
I love this pirate.
Right.
He's funny. We got to do more with him.
It's the same actor, Alan Lee, who did the voice for the old man in the restaurant.
Oh, okay.
He's actually a local actor here in Nashville. Really,
I think our next
actor.
Movie should be The Adventure of One-Eyed Louie.
With
that
one tooth.
Cool.
He used to have two teeth.
Every movie, we need to pick one character from the movie, and the next movie will be about that character.
Excellent.
And people could vote online. Which character was your favorite? We'll make a movie about him.
Wow.
It'd be like
sort
a
reality
letter.
TV meets cinema.
Which character is your favorite?
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, I like them all.
Oh, yeah.
I actually like the guy next to One-Eye Louie that's waving his sword around and like singing a little song or something, not paying attention. I thought that was hilarious.
And then
suddenly he notices, oh yeah, I'm a big scary pirate.
This is a fun little scene
the
in here.
The powder room.
Yeah,
this is not how I had written it. I'd written it, it was, I don't know. I don't even remember how.
I think it was some sort of a candle down there, like a cigar
candle.
Yeah,
he just came down and looked for something to pull on, and I don't even remember why.
No, to light. I think it was me lighting the wick or something.
I don't know.
He accidentally lit it. I can't remember.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, the bathroom stuff was added by Mike.
Oh, and this was stylistic right here. This is actually just one shot, but we cover it from multiple angles.
Wow.
This was fun to get through and lay out.
To do that.
Getting this whole scene, although I think visually it makes a lot of sense now that it's animated, had to take a lot of time with the storyboards and layout to make sure it wasn't confusing in terms of camera direction, where the ball was traveling and we flipped lines on the camera several times throughout it. But I think it worked out pretty well.
It works. It sings. It's not even a musical.
I told you they were heroes.
Is that the first time we've had Larry spit something out?
I think so, but it's rope, so it's not too bad.
Yeah, that's okay.
Here's one of our first continuity issues.
Did that on purpose?
Continuity issue.
Yeah, the door was closed. Was open. Now it's closed.
Oh,
yeah. Oops. Well, what can you do?
Oops. Oh, I love this set.
Yeah, this is a really fun
set. The next
set.
Movie should just take place in this set with One-Eyed Louie doing a monologue.
It's a monologue.
Like Spalding Gray.
Swimming to Cambodia.
Yes.
But it's great for entertainment. Oh, man. Oh, there they go. Oh, look at the ceiling.
What?
Let's see. The ceiling.
Ceiling?
I mentioned it a little late. The ceiling plate was a painted plate.
It was painted.
It's really pretty. There is no physical 3D ceiling in here. It was painted. But, the lighting and water and everything in here turned out really cool.
I like that. We should have spent more time in there. That was a fun set.
We come back there.
We'll be back there.
We'll be back,
but not for very long.
Yeah.
And I love
keep
this
running
sun,
through it.
This sunset lighting here is really nice. Although
Pretty.
We found out when we got in to the set and started doing lighting that the sunlight doesn't hit the back of the ship too well. And so this isn't one of Eloise's better moments for lighting. Her hair gets a rim, but her face just kind of goes flat.
Right. Well, we all have those moments. His little Eloise.
But George looks good. George kind of turned in the light there. He looks nice.
If it was Pirates of the Caribbean, they would just pay to have the sun moved. Because money is no object.
We don't have Jerry Bruckheimer movie money here.
No, we don't. No, because we have to finance these mostly with credit cards.
and roadside vegetable stands.
Yep, and then hope that we sell enough pirate ships to pay off the credit card. It looks like an inn or something. It's tough business.
Oh, I love that's a nice matte painting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Look at that.
Chuck spent a lot of time
Chuck
on
painted
this.
That. Michael Spooner did the design on that.
Yeah. Mm.
This actual set is a teeny tiny little set. I think your mind goes, you know, your mind is, you know, is set up with, you know, okay,
that's
this,
pretty
this
water.
In on this rock.
That's some good water there.
But there's this whole set consists of just a short staircase and you know, this short piece of porch we're about ready to see. And that's
short
all.
Porch.
Yeah, see this porch right here?
Yeah, I see.
If you pull
look
the camera
the thatch.
Back.
Isn't that nice thatch?
Yeah, the thatch is painted on.
Andrew Woodhouse painted special.
Yeah.
If you were to pull back the camera here, they'd just be floating in the middle of the air above the ocean.
I want to have Andrew Woodhouse paint some thatch on my house, too.
We put everything on the screen. There's no extras.
No extras.
Now, this song wasn't originally in the film. And
what's that all about?
We needed more music, because music is
fun. Says who? Music is highly overrated.
Oh,
it'd be fun to have a piratey song in here. And,
And Mike just sat down and wrote it when we needed it.
Just like that?
Just like that.
Just like that. It'll take a little while. But it's really, really fun working on it. Going to Kurt with the idea for the melody and, you know, shaping it into a real song. And it was funny because Jim Poole, who does the voice for Scooter, did a fantastic job, you know, obviously has always done a fantastic job with Scooter. But we went into the booth to record it. He was originally supposed to sing these lines that he's calling out now. And it just, you know, it just wasn't working out. And so we thought, hey, let's just have him do a square dance call out instead. And it just really turned out well. I love the way Jim performed it.
Michael Spooner designed this set also, which is just beautifully done. Very detailed. He detailed all the props and the set dressing.
It's very Snow White, wouldn't you say?
I'd say Pinocchio.
Pinocchio.
I don't know. I'm not seeing that.
It's fun, too. Just some of the, if you know, kind of freeze frame on some of these things. Joe Spadafore put some, you know, cute little, you know, posters up and missing parrots and stuff carved into the woodwork. Kind of fun to find all those little hidden treasures. Another fun thing about this was tracking the time of day, because we go to twilight to night.
Yeah.
And so we really had to track the amount of light we see coming through the doors and windows on a shot-by-shot basis to kind of make sure that, you know, we did that transition very naturally and very smoothly.
So this filmmaking is really complicated.
Really,
is that what I'm learning?
Good thing you've got a couple years to work on these babies. Otherwise, it would be a lot to think about in a short amount of time.
And these cards, we use the Jonah cards, actually.
Yeah, the cards that they're playing are the Go Fish cards from Jonah.
Which were actually manufactured at one point. So you may have a set of those cards at home.
That's right.
In fact, I do.
That's right.
But I think they're lost in our basement now.
Yeah.
Every now and then one of them will show up in the couch.
Robert's saber there is scaled. It's kind of like the ring in Lord of the Rings. It's different sizes
it
all over the place.
To the wearer.
That's right. If Robert were to be holding that sword at that scale now, he'd be teeny tiny.
I think
but it looks good on Cedric right now.
The cutlass wants to be found.
That's right.
We scaled everyone's swords. The princesses were scaled.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Man, you think kids are going to be disappointed to find that out?
I don't think so.
I think they're going to be okay.
Also, you should notice that no food is eaten in this.
Look at Cedric winking there.
Oh.
You can tell when Elliot winks, but Cedric's wink is a little more subtle, having no eyes.
Yeah.
This is fun. Is that a yes or a no?
Is that a yes?
How did you know
I
was going to say that?
Hope I didn't ruin it for anybody. Hopefully you've watched the movie already before
you
listen to the commentary.
That door is really pretty.
Tim Hodge doing the voice
Robert
the Terrible. Of Jolly Joe himself, who's also Charlie
Pincher.
That's Charlie Pincher.
With more hair?
With more hair. Tim was also the voice of Khalil in Jonah. So.
Yep. Yeah, and he was nominated for an Annie for best vocal performance in an animated film for
We've
Khalil.
We've never been nominated for an Annie.
Lyle the Kindly Viking won the Annie for best
direct video.
Oh,
okay. I'm voice acting.
We're not that good.
Originally, this scene was just a solo by
bartender. This was originally a Jolly Joe monologue, and we thought it'd be cute. And actually, what I was thinking was the scene in Princess Bride with Billy Crystal and his wife?
Yeah.
Thought it'd be kind of fun to have a kind of little sparring husband and wife team. And I don't think it didn't come off as funny as Billy Crystal.
but it's Tim got it still, it still Annie, broke but up. He's not yeah. Billy Crystal.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's not Billy Crystal. But it still broke up. It still broke up the dialogue, you know, with two.
Right. Is Billy Crystal so, one and Annie though?
I don't know.
Did he win one? I took out for Mike and Monsters Inc.
He might have. But one of the things that actually one line that was in here was when Jolly Joe said, "You're just like your mother," as she's going back and forth trying to scare him.
Yeah.
And it was really fun in the initial read through, the way Tim delivered the line. But we did a read through of the whole script before we ever did the final audio for the script. And we just couldn't recapture that same feeling. We tried really hard to get that same delivery and we just couldn't get it. And we didn't have it in its original, you know, the fidelity of the original file just wasn't high enough. So we cut the line because it sounded more mean than playful.
If you've seen The Three Amigos, that moment that just happened there was the moment where Steve Martin gets shot in the shoulder and realizes that they're actually in real danger, that it's not pretend.
Right.
And they immediately flee. You know, and that was one of the movies that really inspired the way to take fake heroes and turn them into real heroes, you know, which usually starts out with thinking, oh, this will be easy. Not that different than hanging out on the couch.
Yeah.
And at some point, something happens.
You get your feet stuck in the pinata.
That was another Three Amigos reference. Yes, that is a funny moment.
Do you have anything besides Mexican food?
Many. We really wanted to use all the lines from the Three Amigos in this film, and we found out that that's technically not legal. But, you know, that's why you hire lawyers. Keep you out of trouble. And this line, actually, these lines right here were added. These lines here were added by Mike. We're not in my original script, especially the sleepy little panda. Which everybody's favorite line.
And that little ding adds a lot to it.
Well, the sleepy little panda always reminds me of John Waba, our editor, who an amazing job putting this all
who
together.
Is black and white furred. Actually, I think that's why. Right.
Well, later in the movie, he is the guard that's asleep in the dungeon.
Yeah.
So he plays the role of the sleepy little panda.
This is a really nice map right here. Chuck Vollmer actually did this map on paper with watercolor.
Really?
With pen and watercolor.
Oh, that's hardcore.
Yep.
Yeah, it's one of the only real pieces of art.
Can you buy it on eBay?
Not if I can help it.
Who has it? Where is it?
Me!
You have it. Man, what did I get out of this?
You weren't supposed to tell
me. I got a printout of my script. Suitable for framing.
This scene was also shortened quite a bit.
It was lengthened and then it was shortened.
Yeah.
That's right.
It started out short, then it became long, and then it became short again.
Yeah. And if you'll notice the clock, it's the same time as it was before, but it's 12 hours later, so it's not a mistake.
Yeah, it's not a mistake. Yeah.
Well, maybe it's
near the equator, you know, it sun up at 6:30, sundown at 6:30. So,
here's the montage.
This is an interesting story with the montage. Originally, you know, it started off as, just a line on the script was, okay, you know, I forget what it was, basically.
They're having fun sailing
George
together.
George gets closer to Eloise.
Yeah. See, writers love montages because they can just, like, write one line that says, montage goes here.
And producers hate them because it's like, what is this?
Somebody else's problem.
Yeah.
So it became my problem. And, actually, so we did about four or five different versions of it, and including trying to figure out, okay, what's the story arc that we have to have here? And basically, we enter the montage with George kind of waffling between wanting to help Eloise, but then also wanting to be one of the guys. And so we enter it with him, you know, trying to be one of the guys. And then at the end of the montage is him actually, you know, taking that step toward being a hero and you know, starting to help
doing
Eloise.
Doing the right thing.
And doing the right thing. So that's kind of the arc of the montage. And so once we got that pegged down, we brought Steve Taylor in. We'd already done some art for it, so we already had some visual gags. So we went through those with Steve Taylor and told him where we needed to go with the arc. And he wrote this song, and it just hit the nail right on the head. And then once he wrote it, it then became really easy then to go in and edit the visuals into it and add a couple more visuals that sort of fit.
Yeah, a lot more.
And really, yeah, and then really lock it down and make it, you know, make it work.
Are those hammocks really hanging from something?
No.
They're midairs.
Somehow I knew you'd say that. Yeah.
This was really the last completed sequence for the film that
really?
We did from a storyboard point of view. Yeah.
Okay.
We delivered it after. Yeah. And all the props in it that had to be designed.
And then Steve had a long-standing relationship with the Newsboys. So Peter Fuller from the Newsboys
sang it.
Furler. I'm sorry. I knew that wasn't wrong.
He's from Australia.
Right. Yeah. So,
as are the rest of the Newsboys.
Yeah. But originally, Steve, when he originally wrote it, he wanted Chrissy Hines to sing it. Remember from The Pretenders?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, hey, that'd sound cool, Steve. That'd be great. You know, she's just a real raspy voice.
These shots.
But then Steve did such a great job on the demo. It's like, hey, why don't you just sing it? Bring in the Newsboys with you.
Oh, fellows, let us not give up.
My favorite
so
shot
easily.
In the movie is coming right up here. I'll point it out.
Okay.
Right there.
Let's talk about those little birds.
Birds.
You know those birds? Tim Hodge, actually, we didn't, in the original script, the original budget of the script, we did not have birds.
There was no bird money.
Budgeted. No bird budget. And what Tim actually got some clay and animated in his garage these clay birds with their wings flapping. So he had stop motion animation with these birds and he shot it. I think he opened the door, his garage door at night and sort of lit them against the darkened sky so he could key them in. And we used them all over the film. So he did a couple different birds from different angles and they
now
just
the film is crawling with birds.
It's crawling with birds.
Did he hang them on string or?
Yeah, he hung them on string.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. He's quite talented, that Tim Hodge.
That's crazy, man. And he's Khalil and was nominated for an Annie.
Want to talk about the Whirlpool?
The Whirlpool, yeah. This was another one of those things that we just kind of had to figure out, okay, what is this thing going to look like that needs to make sense that it disappears
right.
into the cloud,
and this
but
is
yet also
another,
looks like a Whirlpool.
Another reason it's cool to be the writer, because you can describe something that doesn't necessarily make any sense. And then, it becomes someone else's problem.
And it was done by the special effects department and also compositing. Paul Sadolny.
Yeah, yeah.
Did a lot of work on that.
Oh, yeah.
Epic stars.
So we started off with, you know, creating a real whirlpool and then just kind of made it more amorphous from there and created some clouds over top. And Andrew Woodhouse did a bunch of cloud painting and integration.
Now, what inspired that spyglass?
Oh, the spyglass inspiration is from Pirates of the Caribbean. Look at the kind of the dirt on the inside of the spyglass. As we were doing the development for this, is when Pirates of the Caribbean 3 came out, and I just thought that was so cool.
Yeah, but now the film is not a parody of Pirates of the Caribbean.
No.
And actually predates the first Pirates of the Caribbean movie,
yes.
Which is why it was not a parody,
yes.
Just so we can set that record
exactly.
straight.
Exactly. Yeah,
because some people, you know, say, "Hey, that's not a very good parody of the Pirates of the Caribbean," and we say, "Well, you're exactly right. It's also not a very good parody of Snow White, which it wasn't intended to be either."
Yeah, although you do mention Edward Scissorhands here.
Yes, but that's
not a parody of that.
That's
either.
Not paradoxical. Paradisical.
Paravicicles. Oh, the beach. One of the huge challenges in this film was water. You know, and there's a lot of water in this film. So we always had to look for ways of maximizing the feel of the water and
right.
minimizing the expense of the water. And one of the
what's most expensive is when it
interacts
with land or anything.
Right.
Yes.
Right. So actually, water coming up on the beach, which we have quite a few shots of in the film. We tried to limit those, as you'll see here. We're sort of the beach itself is hidden by a lip of sand, so we just wanted to make sure
sand
we spent...
had lips.
Yeah.
Well,
sand has teeth.
And unfortunately, what the sand doesn't have is little footprints or hop prints, which would have been great.
That's
but
very expensive.
It's extremely expensive,
you know,
and we put the money elsewhere.
Sure. Yeah.
Next time.
Well, see now you can't get away from showing the beach here. So this was a money shot where we had to put the waves, and they look really nice.
Mike
so
and Phil, these are you two guys in this boat, and
yes,
they're
that's right.
just
that's
adorable
us
characters.
Guys.
Oh,
thank
and,
you. We
and,
think you're adorable too.
Thank you.
Inspiration for the look of the water. You know where that came from?
Water.
water from water itself, but I also I loved the remember the Disney Tarzan film
yes.
that came out a number of years ago?
Yeah, we looked at that for Jonah.
We looked at it for Jonah, but we couldn't afford it in those days. So I always loved that water because it just had a great stylized feel to it, and so you know that's what we use for inspiration. It's like, let's make our water look like that.
And do you know what the inspiration for the cave was?
Gilligan's Island.
An intestine.
Gilligan's Island intestines. Gilligan's skipper.
My intestines.
Well, it kind of was shaped like one.
Yeah, we actually, yeah. when we did the Prevez model for this whole cave scene, it's very, you know, it's very specific as to the path they take through, and Sedgwick falls down this, you know, hole and gets chased yeah. by these cheese curls and then goes out the other end. And as we created the actual 3D model for it, it looked like an intestinal tract is sort of, you know,
wow.
disemboweled from a cow.
Is that something I can buy on eBay? That's pretty cool.
But really, we took the whole Gilligan's Island cave philosophy here. You know, there's really no motivated light source in here.
Yes.
It's just,
light
know.
Just shows up.
Well, right it here it up. Is. It's motivated by the cheese curls.
Oh, yeah. Here we have this sort of golden glow of the cheese curls.
Self-illuminating.
Yeah, exactly.
They're like glow worms.
Yeah.
And I think this sort of thing just came as I was writing it from the notion that it's, and this is, again, you know, because Pirates of the Caribbean was one of the first attempts to make a pirate film supernatural, which is why a lot of people say most pirate films failed, because it just wasn't that interesting, but they added mm-hmm. supernatural elements, which this also has, but it's not because Pirates of the Caribbean, it's actually, I was looking at things more like Voyage of the Dawn Treader in Narnia by C.S.
Right.
Lewis,
yeah.
where you have just a great adventure that unfolds, you know, episode by episode
yeah.
with different kind of supernatural and very interesting interactions with different kinds of creatures.
Sure.
And since cheese curls had been a running gag for them for quite some time,
yeah.
so what could be you know more of a bait to lure one of them away
right.
for a lifetime supply of cheese curls, but then what's the last thing you would expect to happen next
mm-hmm.
is the cheese curls come to life and turn on you.
That was very cool. Although, you know what would have worked better with those little invisible creatures from Voyage of the John Treader? A lot less expensive to animate invisible creatures.
Yeah, originally
creatures.
We could only
yeah.
animate like 10 of them in a shot, those
yeah.
little cheese curls. But then they
yeah,
gave us more and
talk
more.
Talk your way into
and
more.
The character design on these was it was like, it was. I think the only time I remember like a design artist coming back and the first design being the one that, you know, was obviously the best design.
Yeah.
Rob Corley did the design for these cheese curls. And, you know, he just showed it to us, and it's like, yep, that's the one.
And Baxter Merry, our sound effects guy, did the voice.
Yeah, Baxter Merry did all the cheese curl voices.
And he named each one of the cheese curls. He had a different name for each one and a different voice.
Really?
Yeah.
Although we didn't find that out until after the credits were done, that he did all of their voices.
Because we would have given him credit had we known.
So this is our credit to Baxter. Word up, Baxter.
Boy, is he sore.
No, he's a good sport about it.
Send him that map. That'll make it up for him
when you pry it out of my cold dead fingers.
Hey, that looks expensive.
Yeah,
the water went in the little thing there.
Yep.
Oh, and remember the help seeker when you had to write out what the help seeker did so people could follow blue or
oh,
red?
Oh, yeah, the help seeker had its own set of notes.
Apparently, the script did not make it clear enough exactly what the rules of the help seeker
right.
were.
So look, it's a spyglass with magnification.
Yeah.
And the wrong pirate is on board.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm giving away all the secrets.
I don't know what she's talking about.
Comes the boat.
Ooh, that almost took his nose off.
This is another helpful piece of feedback we got from Universal development team is actually have the rowboat come down.
Yeah, the script did not call for the rowboat to come down.
Yeah.
But now it's down. You see? So. Don't you enjoy it more?
It just gives us a clear visual as to Elliot's choice. Do I go in this rowboat or
right.
George's
boat? Number one
or
boat number two?
Yep. And we sort of set up the camera here as we cut around when George is pushing off the boat. We do a camera angle that we reuse later, but, you know, to kind of make you wonder, is Elliot really there or is he gone?
I was wondering.
Yeah. So you go here and you see Elliot there.
Yeah, I see him.
You get him. He pushes the button.
Pushes.
The boat flashes.
It's
gone. Go back to the same angle.
Something's
gone. Oh, he must have skipped town. But he didn't skip town. He just pushed the button without being in the boat, and the boat went away. And there
he is. Are you sure?
That's what happened.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah.
Wow. Now, the score there in that emotional part, the score on the emotional parts is kind of reminiscent of Bug's Life. Why do you think that is?
Man, we used for our rough score pieces of, I don't know, probably 30 different movies. So John Waba, who just does a great job with placing temp score, he and I went through and...
But that was the temp score, because Kurt's score is totally original.
It's totally original.
Totally original. But, you know, you have to, you know, laying out temp score, the reason for that is just sort of to inform the emotional tone and some of the pace of the shot. So we used some Bug's Life.
It has the emotion of Bug's Life.
Yeah, the emotion of Bug's Life.
Yeah.
But then we recorded the score in Prague with the 79-piece orchestra.
That's right.
Just Prague? Is that in Minnesota? Where is Prague?
That's in the
Czech Republic.
Oh, my. Well, that's quite a drive just to record a score.
It sure is.
And well worth it.
For the food, I hear. I didn't go. Because I wrote the script and, you know.
Yeah.
Right.
Here they come. Here comes the cheese curls. This was inspired by the Mummy. Cheese. Remember the little scared beetles in the Mummy?
Yes.
That's kind of the feeling I was looking for.
And also, when I wrote it, I was thinking about Lord of the Rings when the goblins start coming down the columns.
Oh, yeah.
In the Mines of Moria.
Oh, yes. This kind of almost looks Mines of Moria-ish.
It does.
Moria-ish.
Almost-ish.
And so here we had to set up the lighting. It took us a long time to get through the exact look of the lighting here. Because later we have to reveal this little piece of light coming through, and it can't look like it's just coming out of left field.
Right.
My favorite line's coming up.
No, you like Sleepy Little Panda.
No, I like this.
Like everybody else.
Good Life. That one day between 2 and 2:30. I love that line.
Bit by the crab.
Hey!
Oh, this is another thing we added too, because remember the script? The crab showed up with a photo of Ellen.
Yeah.
And so we set that up earlier in the restaurant where the photographer comes by and snaps their picture, so we get some reference for it.
Yep.
So, and there's the little bit of light. Make believe that the sun maybe shifted a little bit.
The crab will show me the light.
Yep.
Comes a cheesy.
See, the screenwriter ended up with only like 27 days to write the script because he was in a big rush. And so you leave some loose ends. Things not quite tied up.
Poor
Phil. That can all be good, though, because it, you know, lets you work it out in story and see what works best.
Then you come up with even better stuff.
Yep.
Like Sleepy Little Panda.
Everybody adds something else to it.
Yeah, the crab turned out really cute.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And look at how many cheese curls we ended up with in this scene.
A lot more than 10.
Yeah.
That's what I say.
Thanks to the guys at Stars.
Yeah, had to sell some of the office furniture to pay for them, but got it paid for.
My soul.
I remember when the modelers first finished this scene, it wasn't steep enough.
Oh.
And so...
that's a nice looking shot.
And so it actually, we had to go back in and steepen up the whole set.
Wow.
My favorite shot is coming up.
Oh, time for Paula's favorite shot.
And...
There.
One.
Oh, yeah.
It's just beautiful.
That's a pretty shot.
Don't you wish you were on that beach?
I do.
Yeah.
What a nice beach.
Okay, this,
meanwhile,
in Robert's Dungeons, you know, this would be a good time to talk about kind of how we did a lot of our pre-viz work in the film. What we did on this film, which we'd never done with VeggieTales before, typically what we would do is draw a map for each location and kind of show where the characters are, sort of overhead 2D map where the characters are, where we'll place the cameras.
In watercolors?
In watercolors, yeah. And then we'd hand that off to the storyboard artists, and, you know, they'd storyboard, you know, with those guidelines. But what we did with this film is we actually built every single set virtually in Maya, in wireframe models, and then actually, you know, took in, you know, rough characters and rough props, and actually composed most every shot in previs.
It's sort of like doing live action where you block your actors and then put your camera in.
And then put
figure out the shots.
Big effects movies like Transformers, they're doing that more and more.
Right.
Yeah. You know, building, kind of laying out a whole city on the computer, working out their shots, and then doing it in the real world.
Yeah.
And that way you know if your shots are really going to work or not.
But, you know, they got the idea from us.
But it works so well because then later in the layout processes, which is when you reconcile your 2D storyboards to, you know, your 3D geometry, because the storyboards themselves were based off of original 3D geometry, everything worked so much smoother. So, you know, that particular scene in the dungeon, or in the little interrogation room here, there's a lot of dialogue and there's a lot of, you know, crossing and, you know, just reblocking of characters. So we were able to work all that out, you know, with a real camera in a real space before we ever went into storyboarding.
And make sure it works properly without the looks being wrong.
Right, right. Yeah, because if you don't follow your rules of camera, you know, you can end up confusing the audience very quickly.
I really enjoyed doing that with you and Chuck.
Yeah,
that was really fun.
That was fun.
See how much his beard is moving as he talks?
Yep.
We could never afford to do that in the videos. That was too expensive. But in a movie,
that's right.
Your facial hair can move.
That's right.
I love show business.
This was added later on, too, to give the time element.
Yep, yep. The ticking clock. I know it's kind of a cliche, but it works. Throw an hourglass in there. I know a lot of film buffs will roll their eyes, but
yeah, roll away. It's working already.
Working already. We've got a set amount of time, and we got to get it done before that.
Oh no! I didn't realize there was going to be a ticking clock.
Oh, another little ditty.
Yeah, that seemed like a good contrast for a completely goofball song. I actually thought about having him sing, you know, these two little verses, and then Paul makes him stop, and so instead he starts singing Billy Joe McGuffrey. Goes through a couple verses of that.
That'd have been funny.
Yeah, if you haven't seen Jonah, you don't get that. But
I remember in our rough read through of the script, I sang that little song. I didn't know what you were thinking of in terms of a melody,
right.
And I got that in my head. And then when we did the final recording, you
couldn't sing anything
what the
else.
Melody was. I couldn't do anything else. So my melody won.
I'm going to refuse to sing your next melody. Oh, sorry, I'm just not hearing that.
You just got to, you know.
Here's what I'm hearing.
You got to be there when it's first implanted on my
printed.
Brain. It's like imprint is like a baby duckling.
Are you the baby duckling, or is the song the baby duckling?
I don't know how that metaphor works.
Okay, it was a nice one though. Look at me, we're walking rocks.
This was another
this
one.
Is another
this is one of the ditties. I used the one that came into my head first.
Yeah.
You try to tell me your melody.
It's like,
that's not the melody.
Before I could come down and sing it for him. Oh, too late. Mike gets credit for that one.
And all the royalties.
And all the royalty checks. Yeah.
I just got my ASCAP number. Can you tell?
And,
here comes the clapping pass opening up.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Hey, Elliot.
Now, the rocks in the background there, are those built or painted?
Those are built. Just the texturing on those rocks is just amazing.
Yeah.
Our lead texturing guy, was just an amazing.
And
amazing.
Your daughter is also the little rock girl.
Oh, yeah, he does the voice of the little rock girl, and then the rock boy.
And I love the baby because he has a diaper on.
Yeah,
rock diaper. How absorbent is a rock diaper?
Very.
And
absorbent.
What actually comes out of a rock baby that requires a diaper?
Pebbles.
And banana.
crushed gravel.
You see, oh,
here he comes. More birds.
Oh, and those are clay birds.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
My gosh.
And the question is, where is the rock mama? Is she getting her hair done?
We don't know if they... Oh, I guess they have two genders in their species.
Yes,
sure.
There's a little boy and a little girl.
No, she's just out.
Yeah. But I think it's the mothers that do the primary breadwinning in the rock species.
Oh. Yeah.
And
okay.
The dads are stay-at-home dads.
Okay.
They're like emperor penguins.
Yes. They hold the eggs on their feet.
I love Sedgwick doing the breaststroke.
And look, oh, yeah. We found that the breaststroke is the only convincing stroke for Sedgwick.
And he almost...
Butterfly doesn't work
for him. He almost actually looks wet.
Yeah. There was a wet version of Sedgwick that was used
both
there.
We never
had
wet versions in Jonah, right?
Yeah, no wet versions.
We just didn't have the time for that sort of thing.
We tried to do everything we could.
Love the little pigtail trees on the rock girl.
Yeah.
Those are great. And look at the shake on that.
Yeah, the water coming off them. At first, we didn't have water, but we added that, too, because it really looks much better.
Spared no expense.
Spared no expense. No.
This was another scene where laying all this out in 3D was just indispensable when it came to really doing it later on. But, you know, just making sure all these camera angles and moves worked. And, you know, Todd Carter, who boarded the scene, scene also added, you know, a lot to the feel and to the emotion of the scene.
Yep.
And there's a lot of effects and sound effects and music in this. This is a real combination of our sound department.
Yep.
Kurt used the pirates who don't do anything theme a lot through the movie to hold it together.
Yeah, are they going to make a little rock monster play set so I can play that scene in the comfort of my own home? Oh no, we've got to get through the pass before it closes. See, that's its own little ticking clock element right there.
Yep. You notice how much like Nineveh that looks? With water around it?
Yeah, it is Nineveh-esque.
Nineveh at sea.
But the wood is different. The wood is very snow white in this movie.
Or Pinocchio. Okay.
No, Jonah was Pinocchio because it had a whale.
Yeah, that's true.
This is Snow White because it has...
I don't think that's possible. And that's coming from a guy who just swam 92 nautical miles without arms or legs.
Well, you got a better idea?
More of that water lapping up on the beach.
Yeah.
It's really cool. I like the playfulness of this. This was Todd's serving suggestion here for the rock monster to sort of pinch the top of the mask with his fingers.
Can you help?
Right. And then Chuck painted in that flag.
Oh, yeah, the flag was missing.
The flag was missing, so I made him paint the flag.
The flag is painted?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Painted in that shot. Okay, here we go. This is fun. A lot of these action sequences, one of the other things that we were able to do on this film that we haven't been able to do on any other film, you know, with Jonah or any of the other episodes, is do a lot of editing after the fact, after animation, to really tighten the action sequences and make sure, you know, they're cutting really well. It's really hard with animation in particular to pre-visualize exactly how long everything is supposed to take, and so you get as close as you can. But we had the luxury this time of going back in and, you know, trimming and editing after everything was done to really cut it more like we would cut a live action film. So, really helped with the action.
Well, I like that they're rowing as they're going in the oars
right
here.
Right.
That
and
was Tom Ruzicka's suggestion right there, one of the producers over at Universal. To actually have the rock dad waving, so we didn't feel like he'd run.
He
didn't jump into the sea.
He's okay.
And then we got rid of the oars when they went through the pass, because the oars were also a kind of a issue trying to
trying to track the oars.
Track the oars, keep the right color oars on the boat.
They got clipped off by the clapping pass.
Right, but before that, we had to have the right oars on the right boats.
Yeah,
we had to do an oar pass.
Big oar tracking spreadsheet.
Yeah.
This is a really fun set in here too, you know, just this mist, and part of the reason for having this mist, we kind of, you know, the idea here is it's sort of this geothermic area where you know, the sort of the earth you know, bubbles up and opens and closes the pass, but it's all this, you know, warm water,
right? And that maybe that activity helps fuel Robert's machinery.
Yeah, his device.
Now, remember these bubbles, Mike?
Bubbles.
How many times did you look at these bubbles?
Hey,
they were too big to begin with.
There's bubbles.
Yeah, a lot of bubble passes just to get the bubbles just to
just
the right
the
size.
Right size.
Just the right size. Not too big, not too small. The other thing we wanted to do with the mist in here is kind of have the sea monster. We wanted to have him give it the feeling of being a real sea monster, and if you know you look close, you can actually see that it's
got
mechanical.
Bolts.
They don't know it's mechanical.
But they don't know mechanical. Yeah, we want to have them feel like it's a real monster, real sea monster, real dragon. So part of, you know, having the mist had to do with kind of hiding that dragon a little bit, and then revealing that it's mechanical later. And we do a lot of quick cutting to it, so you can't examine it too much until it comes to a stop.
And I love how you directed Elliot here.
Oh, yeah.
With the little
stand
wimpy
back
song.
And wave like a girl.
Hey, I know some very competent swordsmen. You have just offended. We're going to get letters.
Oh, didn't mean to offend.
But Paul Conrad did the design on the sea serpent. Just a really great job on it.
And I think Baxter probably did the burp.
Yeah, burping by Baxter.
Hi, guys.
And you had to make the lever show up.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's kind of key.
Yeah, if you remember back to the prophecy, a lever will help save your friends.
Set you free.
Guys?
Set you free?
Mm-hmm. Set you free, I think.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. When all
then the king says, the lever that saved your friend.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, we better get back to those guys. See what they're up to. Remind people that they still exist.
Yep.
Now, the dungeon, I had to draw out because from the script, nobody could figure out what the heck I
Look,
was talking
about. We're back in your favorite set.
Oh, I love this place. Yep. Oh, let's stay. Freeze it. Pause. I want to stay here. If we pause, can I keep talking?
We they do look kind of neat going up
that's
there.
One of, yeah, that's one of your favorite scenes here. That Chuck painted that doorway.
Yeah,
we couldn't
beautiful.
Get that to look right in the model, so we just painted
and
it.
And that's awesome.
Yep. Yeah. This is. I love this scene. I love the way the water plays in the scene and the lighting here. Really nice.
Yeah. Well,
turned out really great. We actually have a mossy texture painted, you know, right on the water level and below the water level.
Wow.
Again, this is all thanks to Chuck.
That's awesome.
And Andrew
and that, Alan Kennedy, that who wheel was the head of compositing and lighting.
Originally in the script was a lever, but then we realized it would confuse people whether that was the lever the prophecy was about or the lever in the sea monster.
Right. So we made it a wheel.
This almost looks like it's made from a real model in here. Mm-hmm. I love the feel of this little scene.
Yeah, I always feel like it's a model. Yeah.
The hourglass.
Oh, look, the ticking clock is still ticking.
I would like one of those hourglasses. I think that would be cool. Yeah. A little mine hourglass.
I'll open my computer and give you one.
So this blueprint for the engine.
Yes, I had to, you couldn't really tell from the script how this was all supposed to work out, so I finally had to draw it out and make the blueprint and say, look, they're over here, the cells are over there, the guy with the keys is sleeping over here, the little car can go through here and go up the wall, but then they started building it, or did a drawing of it, and the wall had a stone overhang, and the car wouldn't have been able to get through, so I'm going to change that. It was very complicated.
Yeah,
it took me minutes to solve.
Thinking up stuff doesn't take as long as actually making it.
No, that's why I like to think it up and then leave.
And there's the labor-saving device, which Paul Conrad also designed.
And it was in Larry's bag.
Yeah,
the whole time.
In case you're wondering, it showed up in the montage, so
it was
it's
in
been
Larry's
with
bag.
It's
in
been his bag with the
help
seeker
the whole time.
Yeah. It's a good bag.
It's a very that's stretchy.
John Waba, our sleepy little panda, voice of the snorer.
Yeah.
He makes a great...
Eric Murray did the animation here. A lot of just great animators on this film. Paul Kohut, who did the animation director, and everybody was just so invested in the film and really gave every shot their best. You know, and it's just... You know, Eric Murray did the, you know, the little
this was
animation
a,
of
this
the
This was a gag that came up in storyboarding.
Device.
This wasn't in the script.
Oh, yeah.
Where he drops the key on his head.
Yep, Todd Carter pitched this gag. And
Paul Kohut really led his troops well. There were many, many animators, and they did a superb job.
Oh, yeah. Hundreds. Fantastic.
In dailies every day, just amazed at what they did.
Yeah. There it goes. It's going to drop.
Oh, look, donkeys. Did you see the donkeys? Yep.
Yeah, and that's the other thing in our layout, in doing our previs, our you know, before storyboards, is really laying this out and kind of foreshadowing the donkeys and, you know, kind of, you know, letting you know that they're there before they come into play in the story. Able to.
Yeah, Mike's a good storyteller, he diddle.
Time's out.
Oh, stop.
Time's up. Look, donkeys.
Donkeys. There's more donkeys.
Foreshadow number two. Got the people out. Pa's going to be a leader. Or not?
We gotta go!
Look, donkeys!
More donkeys.
Quick, have you got it by now?
No!
Oh, poor. This is not quite there yet.
Trying to figure out a grape making a crucial decision without words or eyes. Hopefully we got that across. That the whole idea there is he's, should I stay or should I go?
should
I lead or should I concede?
Ready to lead for a minute and then back down.
He hasn't quite reached that point.
They're heroes.
Because he hasn't seen how he'll be helped.
But he will soon.
Help will come from above.
The king's heroes? Then you can answer my question.
And of course, this is the crucial point where the villain calls the posing heroes to task.
Surely the king's heroes would know of his plans.
And they have to reveal, you know what, we're not really heroes. This is the saddest part of Three Amigos 2. The saddest part of Galaxy Quest.
This is the climax.
All the movies where this happens.
Yep, when they are found out.
We're no heroes. We're cabin boys. We work in a restaurant.
And then they have to backpedal to try to save their own skins.
We give people refills on
which
their soft drinks.
Worse.
That's right. The king's heroes? He's so lazy he can't even climb a ladder without giving up.
Yeah. And, just looking at Robert's sword there and the inlay on it.
Very nice. It's true.
Beautiful design.
And I was thinking about Elliot's sword, which we had to track also.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of sword
tracking.
I'm the
queen of tracking. Yeah.
Yeah, because Elliot, through much of the movie, has a wooden sword, but he needed a metal sword, actually, to take on the sea monster with.
Right.
So we had to figure out, okay, when does he get it, and when does it go away?
And when does he get it back again?
And when does he get it back again, his wooden sword? Jeepers. Okay, this is
oops, did you see the wax? Dropping.
Yeah, when
that
I
was painted wax right
first
there.
Saw that, I was thinking there was a bird above him.
Yeah. See, so it could kind of be funny, but then you figure it out because you cut above to the candles.
Yeah.
And the question is, how long is he going to have that on his nose for the rest of the movie?
But we account for it because watch when he turns his head, the wax flies off. Right.
Where does the
wax
go?
So he's got the wax. Okay. He's looking down. That's his POV. Watch this. He turns and the wax flies off.
There it goes.
Oh. Lands on the ground.
Wow.
So.
And that's what Robert was saying. Where'd the wax go? Didn't you just have wax on your nose?
And look at that sword go.
Yep. Bam, smash.
Yeah, when I first read this scene, I thought there was going to be fire.
Yeah. Oh, the panels go out. I loved having Robert disembodied from his suit of arm or his mechanical suit there. Gets him embarrassed.
Was he beheaded or was he disembodied?
No, he's just a gourd sitting on a suit. Robotied.
Oh, guard went back
to sleep. I love the way he runs.
Oh, yeah, his run cycle is really fun.
Really great.
Yeah.
And this scene was inspired by just researching fortresses and noticing spiral stone staircases in one fortress.
Where they can go down like a roller coaster.
Yeah, in a cistern in another fortress that was really cool. A stone cistern.
Is that where you live?
I live in the cistern.
In the fortress.
No.
Probably on another commentary on here, you'll see all the research Chuck did on Caribbean, pirate fortresses and castles.
Oh, and I love this toilet shot.
Yeah, a lot of the outside of the Robert's fortress here is based on what really existed in the Caribbean.
He said, "I'm feeling flushed." I'm feeling flushed.
Yes.
Here they go down the drain.
The script either.
I think that was Tim. That was Tim. That was Tim's line.
Just keep popping up. Popping.
To the
penguins.
There they go. Back over to Sea Monster.
The Sea Monster wasn't originally there either, but
but
the storyboard artist put it in.
Yeah.
We think it's funny.
Yeah.
Okay, here it goes. He's rowing.
And the notion was that there was some sort of a steam propulsion system to shoot the ships out.
Robert harnessed all this geothermal energy.
Well, so we haven't talked about them rowing without arms or legs.
No.
But it's so convincing, isn't it?
It is very convincing.
Yeah, I don't even think about it.
There you have to use the force.
Okay, one of my favorite shots of the film is coming up here. It's a shot similar to this. It's not this shot, but next time we're
like
over the shoulder of Robert.
Shot. Next shot you see that's like that shot is
that's
Mike's
my favorite
shot.
Yeah.
We all have our favorite
shot. But it's not my favorite shot. It's different.
And this we had to do this to give that Pa helping Eloise, but we didn't want to get her wet.
Another chance.
Yeah, you didn't want to have her actually fall in the water.
Because that would be
that's more expensive. Yeah,
and then she would have looked wet the rest of the movie.
That's right.
Yeah.
And her hair.
And some people who have watched this haven't noticed, really, that the heroes don't...
That's my favorite shot, right there.
Oh, there it is.
I like
Yay!
That shot. That's just so dynamic. Woo-hoo! Over Robert's shoulder there with the little characters in the background.
Yeah.
Okay, now this shot was really complicated to do, get the, the big effect shot, getting these rocks to break and fall and splash and everything. And we actually built it much longer than it needed to be and used the parts of it that, we liked the best.
And the camera shake, Mike likes to shake.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I used a lot of camera rumble just to kind of help sell weight. So there was a lot of camera shaking going on.
Sometimes Mike just shakes his own head. He likes that effect. But some people haven't noticed that the heroes in this movie do not, in fact, save the day. They don't solve the problem. The problem is solved through intervention of someone from above.
That's right.
A higher power that called them into the adventure in the first place. And that's
right.
Really what makes the film distinctly Christian.
That's right.
Because a typical American movie would say, you can do anything you set your mind to. Just follow your heart and you'll never go astray. And that's not what we're saying here at all. You can do anything that God calls you to do if you just do what you're called to do and trust that he'll be there to help. That's what the king represents.
Get it?
That's right.
That's your Sunday school lesson for the day. I love the kingship It's based off the Steadfast design, but in a much much more impressive and regal. If you were to put the Steadfast, which is the prince and princess's ship, next to it, it would be much smaller.
His sword sure is shiny.
Yeah, he's got a shiny sword. But this, as far as the deck of the king ship, this is the only part of the ship that was designed because, this is the only part where we actually shoot. So we had, a model, a wide shot model of the king ship built, and then we just built this front bow area of the ship.
I love the way they look at their little medals.
Yeah. Yep. This was kind of like the end of Star Wars.
It's very Star Wars-ish.
In fact, in the script, it said at one point, we look off to the side and R2-D2 is chirping and happily.
We couldn't have R2-D2, though.
It's legal issues.
Yeah, we couldn't.
If it was short, no one would have noticed.
I would have noticed.
Chuck, our production designer, actually collects World War One and Two medals from Russia and Germany.
Did that help?
It helped because those medals are actually designed after, I think it's World War One Russian Navy medals. So there's a Russian Navy medal that looks like that. Isn't that amazing?
That's just what we needed.
Yep.
World War One Russian Navy.
Yep.
Exactly. It makes the film look. His facial hair moves too.
That's
man.
Right. The king. Oh yeah. Everybody's got moving facial hair. The king.
No expense.
The king is the same actor as Robert. Ken Clark did a great job.
Saying? What are you saying?
Because
about
they're brothers.
Well, no, we're not making any point other than it was nice having one guy do both voices.
We only had to fly one in from Los Angeles.
Cheaper that way.
Yeah. One per diem, one flight, one hotel room.
Two for one sale.
But he did a great job on both voices.
Yeah.
And it made it convincing that they were brothers.
And originally we were going to have two people, but he just did such a great job.
Yeah, it's kind of like Peter Pan, where the father and Captain Hook are played by the same actor.
That's right.
Kind of like that.
But not really. Not.
You see R2-D2 there in the corner?
And see all the bald carrots? They're all bald.
Oh, yeah, those are bald carrots. Bald. Hair is costly.
Happy, it's a touching scene.
Where's the confetti?
Aww. Isn't that pretty? Look at the light there.
Just wait. We can always use it's not the end yet.
Okay, will we see it again?
We see what?
The pretty light scene? What was that? It was like a second.
Yeah.
I want more.
Had to move through.
I want more.
You can watch
it
again.
That's what pause is for.
That's a big anchor, man.
It is.
Holy
it is a big
cow.
Anchor.
Yep.
Here's Robert.
Wait a minute. He's been alive all this time.
Yeah, you'll see how.
And we accounted for that too. We gave him a little breathing apparatus.
Yeah.
Nobody else needs one, but Robert does.
Right. To be underwater all that time, you need a little canister with air in it.
Yeah. The show's on. It must be
Friday. I guess you're wondering what he spits out of his mouth coming up here. That's what it is.
It would have been funny if it was a little canister of helium. So he pulls it out and talks in a high voice.
Yeah. There he goes.
There it is, the breathing device.
The breathing device.
And all the pretty stars in the sky that Andrew added.
Mm-hmm. All the pretty stars.
The pirate ship adventure here seems a little smaller now in scale to what we expected.
There they are!
Mm-hmm. Yep, back to the real world. Less big.
They still haven't eaten their turkey legs.
We composed the shot. The same way we first composed Robert's introductory shot when he came aboard.
Oh, yes.
We did the same thing there.
But it's true. I see it now.
Yeah.
That was a great idea.
Thank you. Oh, and he thinks Sir Frederick was when we felt the need to actually have George say that. Because I don't know how anybody could think that was George.
Same hat,
yeah.
Yeah, but different color.
But he is big
color.
And orange.
Well,
he's in the same costume.
Yeah, he was underwater for like 6 hours.
He's a little dizzy.
Yeah, and his head's all full of helium. He's practically floating.
This is fun. This is also fun to line this out in previs, this whole action sequence, and figure out what's going to happen with all of the things spinning around and flying through the air.
Right. And also, remember, we had a few different endings for it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the ending of the movie.
I think we picked the best one.
Yep, yeah. It's good to come up with a few different endings and then pick the best one.
There was the one where Larry got the girl. One where he was elected president of the United States. And there was this one. I think you chose well.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
Big finish. That would probably hurt.
Was it?
Ouch.
Ouch.
The scream, was that the actor screaming? Or
yeah, someone else screaming? No, that was him. He had a wide range.
I guess. Mm-hmm. I'm impressed. Mm-hmm. But what's going to happen?
Yay! Yeah.
Where's the confetti? Come on, confetti!
Gotta have confetti. The confetti cannons.
Can I come over to your
gotta
house?
Have confetti.
Oh, we had to deal with a little confetti continuity here.
Really?
Yeah, between those two shots. When we first started and getting the flow through of the cannons that exploded initially.
Does confetti take direction well?
Oh, yeah, because then sometimes it looked like really big pieces of paper, so we had to get rid of them.
How close it was to the camera.
You had to re-render those shots.
That's tricky.
But I think they came up with great confetti.
Mm-hmm. I don't think we need to be in the show after all.
But they learned a valuable lesson.
Life has plenty of adventure of its own.
They will be called into adventure.
And one of the alternate endings was bringing everybody up on the stage, but I think it was just nice to leave them there alone.
It's kind of looking there.
Yeah,
and
like
here comes a help seeker. And originally, that was going to be a different shape.
Different
help
shape.
Seeker.
Yeah, that's what the script requested.
Yeah, it was comical. We actually made that, but that was confusing to some people.
Yeah, and well, I think you know,
like
if you look at the theology,
people.
If you look at the theology of it too, you know,
Don't talk to me about
look at all the characters that Phil and Mike played. Lots of voices.
Yeah, I only got paid once.
I like how the credits came together on this film.
Yeah.
You know, the opening credits and these credits, they all kind of you have a nice little
Carapacepia.
Mm-hmm. Tim Poole, Tim Hodge, Drake Lyle, Ali Naraki, Patrick Sloan, Joe, John Colin Robert, Brian Roberts.
Hold on. Oh, wait, we're not done?
Yes.
More water. Now.
This song rocks. Let me just say, you know, that just re-recording the song was so much fun. And the musicians that came in here in Nashville and recorded this were just top-notch.
Yeah.
Just
and the B-52s actually had to say it was okay.
Yep. They said okie-dokie.
And they said it was okay to do the wigs on the girls that you'll see.
Oh, we had to get permission to copy their wigs?
Yes, absolutely. And Mike actually wrote the words to this.
Yep.
As he does all the silly songs.
Yeah. Oh, and I edited this too. That was fun.
Yeah.
Whoa.
And John helped me out a little bit at the end, cleaning it up a little bit. But it was fun to edit it on iMovie, actually.
You edited this on iMovie?
Yeah, I edited it on iMovie.
That's crazy. So we gotta like pay Steve Jobs a royalty to use it?
No.
Didn't edit the whole movie on iMovie, just the Rock Monsters.
Oh, I love this.
Oh, look,
pop.
Larry's dead.
Yeah.
Larry's back. That's good. This is fun.
Yeah. It's great crab animation. Crab Nation is what you caught.
Yeah.
That's my least favorite film shot in the whole film.
Well,
Larry looks like he's having a little fit there playing the guitar.
Oh.
He tossed us in the ocean.
Wow.
Yeah, and originally you planned this to do some reuse shots, which we did do. When you first brought up the idea, I thought a whole other scene to animate. And then we... Yeah, well, we used some reuse, and I'm so glad we did it. It's a wonderful scene.
We did the stylized water here.
Yeah.
Sort of the theatrical water.
It was from Jonah, wasn't it?
Not that water, but they had kind of the idea of stylizing on a stage.
That crab dances so well.
Yeah.
Amazing what they got the Rock Monsters to do. The splits and everything.
Yeah. They're pretty limber, those Rock Monsters.
Now watch, somebody's having their solo.
All right, so that's a wrap.
There you go.
Can't say Bob wasn't in the movie.
Yeah.
There he is.
I guess that's a cameo.
And it's still not done yet.
Whoa, there's more.
This is
really... Who did all the cheese curls?
Paul Kohut did all the cheese curls. He just did about 10 animation cycles of the cheese curls. And then, actually, Toby Mac, who wrote the song for the credits... I did a rough version of the credits where I went and grabbed another one of Toby's songs and edited, you know, kind of figured out where the cheese curls could go.
Yeah.
And then once he turned in the actual song that he wrote, especially just for the movie, and then I just, you know, threw the cheese curls in.
And if you watch the cheese curls, they move just like Paul Kohut does. We saw him dance once, and he dances like these cheese curls.
That's right.
You peppered the cheese curls?
Peppered the cheese curls.
Peppered cheese curls.
But I gotta say, you know, this song, Toby just did such a great job incorporating the lesson of the film and just getting a really great, you know, fun sounding credit song. I mean, you just want to walk out of the theater dancing.
The record is out on Decca Records, and it's a wonderful record.
Is it?
Yep. Yeah, the album.
Yep. Do I get a copy?
Sure.
All right. Yeah, including an inspired by song that's not in the film, but Matthew West wrote another song, and Mendisa recorded it. So it's another really, really fun song.
And look at all these people. They were all up in stars in Canada, all of these people under production, and they really were all gave 1,000% of themselves.
Yep. Very, very nice job.
Yeah.
And the idea behind sort of the credits, the look of the credits, is kind of stick them in the cheese curl world. So we use the color palette of the cheese curl cave.
Oh, yeah, look at
and
that.
And when you look at it in really high resolution, you can actually see a parallax going on between the background and then the words scrolling. So you kind of get a nice dimension on it. And even the back part of the cheese, of the blue texture, moves a little slower than the side parts of the texture. So.
City of Prague.
Yep, that was a fun trip.
That was wonderful.
That
and,
was awesome.
You know, Kurt,
that's one
Kurt's
of the most,
amazing.
Yeah, the orchestra was amazing.
Work.
Prague is one of the most beautiful cities in the whole wide world.
Where we ate our way through it.
Yeah. If you can go to Prague,
and have
the opportunity to ever go to Prague in your life, go to Prague. It's
and,
amazing.
Yeah, 5 days with a full orchestra recording. Was,
yeah, that doesn't hurt either.
It was nice. Really wonderful. All of our friends at Big Idea.
All of our friends at Universal.
Yep.
Here comes a logo. I like this one where the cheese curl comes up and sniffs the camera, then eats it. It goes, yep. Well, thanks for coming, everybody.
Hope you enjoy the movie.
See you next time.
Bye-bye.